all the visitors. Thanks for coming, and there is some goodies up here to help yourself and rattle your teeth with. Feel free to do that. Additions or changes to the agenda?
One addition I'd like to request we put on the agenda, just further discussion of the Education Foundation funds and the library funding. Put that as item one on section C.
And entertain a motion to approve the agenda, the added agenda item.
Mr. President, I move to report the agenda, approve the agenda as amended.
Second.
Move and second to approve the agenda as amended. Any further discussion? All in favor, right hand. By the same sign, 6-0. Consent agenda items. We have a minute on the November 5th meeting. Bills for payment, budget report, activity fund report. I believe that all those were sent to you.
Mr. President, I move we approve the consent agenda.
Second.
They move seconded to approve the consent agenda. Any discussion? All in favor, right hand. Oppose, same sign, 6-0. Patron comments. Any of you wish to make comments this evening? Or eyes at me? All right. Well, thanks for being participatory. Have our first item of business, career planning.
One of the board goals, which, by the way, we have those up here. I don't remember if I've referred to those, but ensure goal number four is ensure students are prepared for career post-secondary education. Part of that is ensuring kids have a career plan. So Mrs. Hacker and Mrs. Cornwell will show us what they're doing with that, with the career planning. So come on up, ladies. You want me to start this first?
We'll watch this video first.
Okay.
This is just encouraging you to think outside the box when it comes to high schools.
I
things are kind of big to think about, I think. And as we're thinking about educating kids and where our high school's going to go, I think those are good thoughts to think about. Currently, we're working on career plans with the kids, and I think you've had a report on all the different assessments we're giving, correct? Is that right?
I haven't.
You have not? Okay, I'll let you pass these around. This is what we're giving the kids, and these are the different assessments we do with them. And all of them are, we were doing them during LST, and we weren't having enough time to get them done, and so Mr. Bergen scheduled an hour each week for each class, and we should have everybody done except for the freshmen at the end of December. These assessments give kids an idea of whether they're introverted or extroverted, what types of jobs an introvert or extrovert might like to have, just a number of different skills they have that match to different careers. After they go through and do all the assessments, then I sit down with them and we talk about where they might want to go. And after we get that part of it done, then we give that information to Wendy and she'll take it from there. We set long-term and short-term goals for them. With Senate Bill 155, we can get $1,000 for every kid that has a certification after they graduate. I called Bill Scott today, and he said that the paperwork's coming on that. But like if we have a CNA next semester, we can't get the money until after they graduate, so those checks will come out this summer and the paperwork will come out after graduation. I think it's really important for kids to get some kind of a certification when they're in high school, whether they're going to college or not. It's good to have kids work ready when they leave high school. A good example are my kids. Cami left high school without any certification. She left with a volleyball degree. And in college, she worked at a quick shop for $7 an hour. Marcy had her CMA. She went to Kansas City. She worked as a traveling CMA and was making $26 an hour while she was going to college. And so that's quite a bit of difference in how much shampoo you can buy while you're in college. And so I think it's good for us to look for those things for kids. The kids that we already have through, I've got one that would like to take phlebotomy next semester, a senior. I've got, I think, five that want to take the CNA class. I've got four that want to do Microsoft Works training. Mrs. Kinneman doesn't have the software she needs to do that yet, so we just need to figure out how that would work for them to get that certification. And there's one more. You know what it is? I know Isai is looking at a construction program for next year at Hutch, and the question's going to be, are we going to let kids drive to different colleges that... I think it's just all new territory for us, and so figuring out how everything comes together is going to be interesting. A lot of the courses are free right now from the colleges with the state under Senate Bill 155. Kids, I have several that say they want to be physicians, and anatomy and physiology is free, and so they're wanting to take that online. A lot of these things can be taken on BART online, but some of them we just don't have here, and they're going to have to drive to college. It's one of the JUCOs for if they want to move forward. So those are all things you can think about as to how we want to proceed as time goes on. After they've set up their long and short-term goals, Wendy's been helping on the assessments when we have it in the afternoon on the full classes with half the lab. Mm-hmm. And then I think she's going to work on the scholarships, and I'll let you tell them.
And the plans. Once they get through all the testing and they kind of have a goal in mind, and they think they know what they want to do, then I'm going to be working with them on coming up with a plan of study, and I have examples of what those would look like. What that is, it takes all of their information, kind of puts it all in one place, lists what their testing showed, and then it goes through and shows what classes they can take. Now, obviously, for the seniors, they're kind of stuck where they are until unless we can get them into something second semester through the college that would help them out. But it's really going to help out the underclassmen, making sure that they get the classes that they need that we offer that would fit into that. Now, most of our required courses are going to fit into whatever plan they're going to take. Some of these are also the things that they take and that they do extracurricularly. So, you know, if there's something that they are interested in that we don't offer a course in, and they can't get it through the college, even if it's not something that they can afford to take, if it's not one of those that's provided free, then there are extracurricular activities and people with contact and job shadowing and things like that that they can do to get in with people that are in the community or neighboring communities that would have those similar positions. And try to, you know, get as much information to them so that when they do go on for further training, that they really aren't wasting their money. Because the more that they can learn now and as much as they can get for free, the better they'll be. And the more, you know, that we study and we get what they want to do in school and out of school, and they have those lists prepared, then it'll help us narrow down what kind of scholarships they can get and where they're going to go and what they'll be prepared for. And I, you know, I constantly tell the kids that if you're in an activity and you stay in that activity, it has something to do with what your career is going to be in. It's going to be that much better for you when you get where you're going and you can prove that you've had that background and information and experience. So that's one of the things we're going to work on. Obviously, we haven't gotten that far yet with some of these kids because we're still finishing up the testing. But I've tried to guide the seniors this year to start looking for scholarships that aren't community. Because the community waits until, you know, we wait until April for that. But then there are others out there. And I keep trying to let them know and to search. And there's things called, you know, like scholarship.com. They do have some things that would apply to some areas that they're interested in, because it will sort. You put in what you're interested in, what career you're looking at, what college you might be thinking about, what area of the country. It will filter all that out and tell them what kind of scholarships and schools will help them. So there's all kinds of resources that I keep trying to get them to look at, and making sure they're taking all of these assessments. And, you know, not only these, but we also have the ASVAB the juniors have taken, and they don't see it that way. And I try to remind them that this does show you skills. The ASVAB shows you skills. The plan tells you where your skills are in relation to other kids in the state and nation and areas that you're interested in. So it'll help me to have all this information to help guide them in the direction that they need to go.
So every student right now has one of these on file?
Not yet. That's our next step. That's our next step. And it's going to take a while to do. And I may have to have Mrs. Cornwell help me on some of those, because we're trying to get as many done as we can.
Are you starting top down or bottom up?
Bottom up.
Yeah, we'll start with the freshmen.
Freshmen.
Because
eighth grade is listed here. I didn't know if you were.
We're not doing eighth grade
at this point this year. But we'll start with the freshmen so that they can make sure they're in what they have. Because by the time they get to the juniors have already had a lot of classes so far, and we can get them into things. But the seniors are kind of stuck in whatever they're in to graduate, make sure they're in there what they need. But
I have a file with this page as the front of it, and by the end of the semester we'll have long and short term goals on every kid and their career plan and what they think about all the assessments they've taken. So I don't know if that's of any interest to you.
Do you
have any other questions, thoughts, guidance?
How much time do you spend with each student?
It depends on the student. Right. Some students are real focused, and they, you know, I'm going to be a doctor, and I'm going to KU, and I'm going to do this, this, and this. And others have no idea where they're. And, you know, that'll probably go this way through the years, too. And I mean, we talk to them about that, that it's okay to change your mind. It's great to have a focus, but let's take some baby steps.
I keep telling some of the kids, the seniors have taken this several times. They took it when they were eighth graders. They took the career pipeline assessment. And they said, well, we've already done this. I said, do things change? They do. And they even recommend that you do that career testing every year. Because as your interests change and your skills change, they might find out that you match something else a little better. So I keep telling them, it's okay, keep doing it.
It's really fun. I mean, I
some
really enjoy the
some
kids.
Some of them really have a good time.
Processes.
And they thought, that really fits me. And then some of them go through and they think, that's not me at all. And I said, well, how did you ask to answer the questions? You know, so it's kind of fun for some of them. And some of them are like, yeah. Oh, that's not helping you much. So.
Do you sense any interest in some type of job shadowing opportunities?
Yeah, I've talked to a few kids, especially we had some last year that were interested, and it was something that they were already doing with the special ed group, community-based training. And I think that that's an awesome resource. I think that it would, if we could get that into other groups besides the special ed, because I think it would benefit other kids to do something like that. You know, spend a semester doing, you know, an hour with whatever area they were interested in. You know, I think it would help out the community as well. The other's interest.
Great. Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you, ladies.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Thank you for coming in.
Any other comments anybody want to make about that? We'll move on to business item number two, city roof applications.
I'm going to turn this over to Mr. Bergen.
I have four seniors that are doing the work release this semester, our second semester. And I have verification from their employer. They signed the parents that I have an employer. And they're all four on course to graduate. And three of them would be going to work after fourth hour, and one would be going to work fifth hour. Just had one more that wanted to do that just recently. So I told them that we start that, and when we go back, when we come back from Christmas break on January 3rd, when we start, when the kids come back. So Shelby Davis will be working in the afternoons. Pat Nemec, I don't know if you know Pat Nemec, what do you do? Rachel Davis will be working in the afternoon. Ashlyn Kelch will be working in the afternoon.
What we need is a motion to approve the senior roof applications in order to allow them to do that. Mm-hmm.
Yes.
That'd be great.
Mr. President, I move we approve the applications for the senior roof.
Second.
And moved second to approve the applications for senior release. Any discussion? All in favor, raise your hand. Opposed, same sign. 6-0.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Bergen.
Thank you.
This next one sounds kind of destructive. Destruction of records.
Need to get rid of some stuff. I don't know how long it's been since we've done that, but we can get rid of the financial records. We have to keep those for 7 years. We can dispose of them after that. There's really no sense in keeping them past that. So I'd be asking for permission to destroy those records from the 2003-04 school year and before. Julianne, did you have anything else to add?
No, we just need to be able to do some cleanup and get some space reorganized and just get rid of some trash. We will be shredding the documents. They won't just be pitched.
And this will be an item on the July agenda. When we do all the routine stuff. We just put it on there every year. We do that. Look 7 years back and get rid of the stuff. So.
Is this the only, your office the only place that needs to be cleaned up?
We didn't ask around. I guess Julian, did you?
I did not. I was just strictly looking at it from a financial record standpoint.
Possibly.
Anything in your offices?
Yeah, there might be a few items that I kind of go through things periodically. There might be a few items there that I can, we can have to.
And I'm not sure if we need to approve all of the school records to be disposed of.
Yeah, just, I mean, it's curious that what requires it to take the board action?
District records, financial records particularly.
I'd entertain a motion to approve the destruction of records prior to 304.
Yes, I move.
Is that right?
Prior to July 1, 2004.
Been moved and seconded to destroy the records. Is there any discussion? All in favor, right hand. Pose same sign. 6-0.
President Spear, I missed the second.
Bill.
Bill.
Okay, upcoming election.
I'm going to turn the floor over to Julianne here, to the board clerk. She'll brief you on this information.
We currently have three seats that will be up for election in the April 2nd, 2013 election. The three seats are position 4, which is currently held by Barb Albers, position 5, held by Carolyn Dunn, and position 6, held by Merlin Spear. Filing date for being put on the ballot is noon on January 22nd of next year. All interested parties must file with the county clerk on or before noon of that day. I'm not sure, I believe that it's not, there's not a, what am I looking for?
Primary.
Thank you, I lost the word. Primary election for board seats, so whoever applies will be elected in the April election. So we do have a pamphlet available for anyone who is interested in becoming a board member. I have them in my office, and the county clerk also has several down in her office.
And then this document is on our website now. I sent it to you in one of the Friday emails just to clarify the district boundaries there. Kind of did that for my own knowledge as well. This is the pamphlet she was talking about. There's some good information in here, just as good reminders for all board members here. I'll go through all of it, but there's some dates in here as well. But if you get a chance, if you haven't done so, you can skim that. I would ask the three positions that are open, if you know whether you're running or not, let me know. I'm not asking you to do it publicly, but just as a heads up, so we know what's going on, and keep that confidential if you'd like. But,
is there a beginning date to get your name on the list down there? Does it have to be after a certain date, or?
Not that I'm aware of.
I don't think so.
Anytime.
I think we're close enough to it now.
Ready for item 5, capital improvements.
We're going to take a quick tour of the building. I want to focus on some areas that may need improvement. This document that's in your packet on page 36, this is a continuation of items that have been completed back into the spring of 2005. That's all of these items here. And then there was a list of, and this is Dr. Kinworthy's document that I found, but I figured most of you were familiar with it at least. And then some possible future projects. We have replaced a Suburban, and we are replacing a van. The AC units, we're really going to need to look at that quickly. Classroom carpeting, some of that's been done. There will be more to come. Library carpeting, single pane windows, we still have some of those that need to be replaced with more efficient windows. Sprinkler system has been done. High school entrance lighting, we haven't done anything on that as far as I know. This is the list of possible capital improvements. What I asked the district leadership team, it's the three administrators and teachers, just to make a list of some things that may need to be added or improved without regard to cost or priority. So ideally, we'd like to come up with a list that the board can prioritize from. And we can't do it all, that's for sure. So it becomes a matter of priorities. So if you have any questions on any of these items as we go along, we're not going to look at all of these things. And then after we're done, we can have some discussion when we come back in here about the items. And from there, if there's other items that you see need to happen, let me know. So
what are those vehicles, those Suburbans, are we replacing one of them, or are those new? Or
those two, the Suburban number 25 is our oldest one, and then the number 31 is the...
is that the one we're replacing, is 25? Or?
No, we already replaced one.
Okay.
And that's not on this list.
Okay.
So both of those Suburbans have over 130,000 miles on them. And the car is in pretty good shape with 65,000 miles. So in a few years, buses, feel comfortable where we're at now, but in the near future, we'll need to look at some things. But okay. So this will still be an open session, but we'll walk over to the building. I want to touch on a few things, and we'll focus on the improvements if there's things you notice that need to be tidied up or anything. Save that for a later conversation. Ask of the board is if you send me items in addition to these. I'm looking to compile an entire list of things. Again, I'm not concerned with feasibility now. You know, we can't do it all. There's a lot to do, and we do have to prioritize and get to that point. And Carolyn brought up a good point there, you know, at some point, but how much money do we throw into the building? Such a big building, but we do have to consider those things.
Would it help you if we sent you what we got with priority?
Sure. And my thought was maybe next month we would hit on and have a better discussion about priority. But start to look at those items.
You just sent us like a list?
This is on our email that you sent us?
It's in the packet, yes. It's in your... in the supporting documents there. Page 44. You know, in addition to that, those things, there's always the ongoing repairs. And we put in a new water heater in the kitchen. I think we're going to have to put a new one in the boiler room. The tank is leaking.
Well, that's so, like roof repairs up there. I mean, roof's leaking, you got to fix it.
Yes. Yeah. So there's all those ongoing things that we have to take care of. So that's all I had for that. I'll put more information in my Friday note.
I'll just mull those over, and I would suggest if you just need to have some discussion about it, stop in and see Josh and visit with him on some ideas. Just get the ball rolling in the discussion.
Yeah.
Okay, we'll move on to added agenda items, which is Education Foundation.
I went to the city council meeting right before Thanksgiving and showed them the information that we have, looked at. They seem open to helping. I didn't ask them for anything specific. I just wanted to present the facts and get that information out there. But again, they do seem willing to and open to helping. But we would need to come up with some specifics. The foundation board meeting, we had that the other day, and in just looking at the what money we have, and we will need to have a meeting with the library board and the foundation board. It's kind of a gray area with that library money being in with the foundation funds, and who controls that, and
I actually don't know why it's a gray area myself.
Okay.
And the reason I say that is because the school is responsible for those funds, period. I mean, that's why this library's set up. And those funds were put there for, you know, donations, and they were put in CDs to be spent in the library. But in the Educational Foundation, they're still for the library. We're not earmarking for anything else.
Right.
So I really don't know what the question is. It's just fiscal responsibility with funding.
And what I'm saying, the gray area is the library, when that money was given, it was for supplies, for books, and specified for microfiche and specific things. Whereas now, as the Educational Foundation, if we're saying we want to use that for operational things, pay the light bill, pay salaries, I think the library board would be open to that. But I guess what I was saying with the gray area is that,
yeah, where it's
does the Education Foundation board say we're going to use that for that, or does the library board need a say in that? And cooperating on that, I think, is the best route. But,
yeah, I see what you're trying to
do. So we're going to have a joint meeting there. The foundation, the funds are not endowed the way we, well, it's not an endowment as such. Who says we can use the money? The foundation board says we need to use the money. The goal is to protect the principal, but it's not necessary. So if we do take more money out than just the gain for the year, that's okay as far as the foundation is concerned. So the South Central Community Foundation, we have to use the money in such a way that they see fit, which is for educational purposes, really. So this discussion is, can we use some of those funds to pay salaries, pay utilities, and some of those things? There is quite a bit of money there that we could be using, I believe, above the $25,000 a year, which we're really not even doing that. We haven't been. But that would help out a lot. One of the things discussed was if you take maybe the three-year average of the balance, of the investment balance, and take a percentage of that, whether it's 3 or 7 or anywhere in between. I think a good national average is 5.5%. So you take the average, that way you're balancing that out. If you have a high year, a low year, a big loss year, that kind of spreads it out over the 3 years, but then taking a percentage of that. So some years you may take more than what the investment gain was. Some years you'll be taking less. But the goal wouldn't be to grow that money. The goal is to use the money for what the specified purpose was. So I think if we can get to 60%, the school district's share of that, those expenses at 60%, that would help out a lot. Which, if we could get the foundation at $40,000 a year instead of $25,000 and bump the city up a little bit, maybe an extra $10,000, that could get us close to that number. So that's kind of where I'm headed with this.
What percent are we at now?
74 almost.
And that was 179,000?
187.
187.
So the numbers were you there? That was from 10-11 school year. So any questions or thoughts on that? I didn't put it on the agenda at first because I didn't really have any solid information, but I did want to update you on that since we had discussed it before.
Has there been a, when's the next library board meeting?
Since we recalled.
That was last week. We had our.
Right, that's what we're meeting. Remember for it. I don't.
Was there recall. One? I can't. There wasn't one tonight.
No.
Okay. Ready for communications, board member Stan.
No, nothing.
Carol?
I'd just like to acknowledge that we submitted a grant this week through economic development that the school did play a nice part in supporting, got letters of support formally, and two, if not three, staff contributed to the writing of that, so I'd like to thank you all for that, and hopefully we'll have some good news in March.
Did you say what it was for?
Oh, it was called the Healthy Communities Initiative through Kansas Health Foundation, and it would provide a resources for planning that in turn may help us be more prepared for other larger grant opportunities that could come down the road. Also encourages looking at existing policies that could be improved upon with no costs. Our request also, at the recommendation of Lisa Cornwell, included an allowance for each of the three school districts to do a Centers for Disease Control school health assessment. So it provided for $500 that would pay for the printing costs and a stipend for someone to complete that assessment. Again, we won't know until March what the outcome of that is, but I do appreciate the work that others gave in completing it.
Okay, Tom?
I don't have anything.
No. Welcome to report. I attended the South Central Special Ed Co-op meeting and just routine things happening there. Just mentioned that the health costs will probably go up. I mean, I mentioned that last board meeting too. Just they don't know what it's going to be due to the Obamacare deal. To be determined, could be a pricing little thing for the co-op. Other than that, just normal personnel changes and so forth. Just they're really working on trying to support students who maybe are nearing their completion, especially the high need areas like school psychologists, help by if you complete that degree and take we'll pay so much if you work for us, you know, maybe I don't know, it's probably $3,000 or $4,000 a year. Just because those are areas that are really speech pathologists, about $3,000 or $4,000. They're working with KU and the 4-year schools on that. So a lot of people are overworked because of that in our area. So they're addressing that need. And that's all I have. So we'll move on to administrative reports. And we'll start with high school.
High school. On the heavy enrollment there, we had a new student in seventh grade start today. So we have that total last up until now was 154. 7 through 12, went through the breakdown by class. mentioned a little bit about band and vocal performance by the junior high last week. High school quiz bowl, we had held an event last Monday night. The annual one we hold at the end of November. Kids did well. Chloe Clark and Isabella Martinez Haskins in the KMEA. I'll try to get some more results for you next time about how they did. I didn't get those from Dave today, but they participated this past Saturday. This week we have our preseason basketball tournament in Larned, as most of you know, all of you know. This week we have CPL meeting, as you all know, just a reminder, you know, Ellenwood's coming into our league. It won't be for another 2 years officially, even though we do play Ellenwood in basketball, in junior high and high school. And they are in track meets. We go to one of their track meets. So, but officially they come in There's been talk about trying to get another school, which would make it 10 after Ellenwood gets in, but I'm not sure exactly where that school would come from. So if there's anything like that, I mean, I'll we'll bring that to the board just to keep you posted on how that goes. We were chosen this year to host volleyball substate, and usually this doesn't happen, and we were chosen to host high school basketball substate and only again too. So, I don't know if it's because they just think that people call and say we like going to St. John or what it is. I don't know. Usually you don't get to host two events in 1 year, but for those who definitely. The only thing, the good thing about it is we don't have to pay bus drivers and travel and anything else, and we can stay home. That's the good thing about it. And the good thing about it is it's you know extra work that week. That's another good thing about it. So anyway, it's a good thing. So. And there should be an activity account report at your place. Thank you.
Thanks for your work, Brian. Even if it's extra.
Even if it's extra. I didn't come out exactly like I meant it.
Elementary principal.
Fifth and sixth grade band concert I thought was very well attended, and after listening to those kids since the beginning of the year, they certainly have come a long way. Benchmark testing will be going on this month. We benchmark our students three times a year, in the fall, in the winter, and then again in the spring. And so in January, I'm hoping to share some class data with you all, just the kind of things that teachers use all the time, to make sure that their students are learning and progressing, and then we're also using that for MTSS grouping. So just to note that that's going on, and again, I'm going to share some more of that with you in January. Teachers attended professional development on Common Core State Standards and Lesson Planning on November 9th. And I've seen some very purposeful lessons in addressing those new standards and the depth of knowledge that we're expecting students to show. K-6 enrollment back at 152, which is what I submitted on September 20th. Have a little fluctuation here and there, and I took a phone call, actually Mr. Meyer did today, we'll be expecting a new sixth grader tomorrow, so that'll be up a little bit. As Mr. Meyer mentioned during the tour, our site council PTO meeting was this evening. We have extensively been discussing improvements to the playground area. And we've been getting quotes on different things. Our most cost-effective solution to the dirt patch is sprinkler system and grass, which you know would require the kids playing out on a practice football field this spring and keeping it roped off this summer. But a couple months of displacement would probably be worth it to have a nice place to play. And really, we believe the only way we could maintain grass in such a high traffic area is sprinkler systems. So we have been looking at some grant opportunities. We have some monies ourselves to spend. But, you know, we've priced several different kinds of options in that area. And then also, again, we'd like to give the kids a nice concrete place to shoot hoops, play four square, things like that, get out that asphalt. It eats up a ton of knees and elbows every year. So, anyway, I've got a really great site council going. They're very energetic and have a lot of great ideas and are really working to put things together. So, and we'll meet again right before the January board meeting. We meet at 6 o'clock before the board meeting's upstairs here, and of course it's open, so you're more than welcome to come sit in and hear what we're talking about. So, elementary building team, we met on November the 15th and kind of got our goals in place for things we want to see both in our students and in our building, so we'll be working on those. I attended a threat assessment in schools workshop at EPIC. It was very, very interesting. And really one of the messages I brought home with me was, you know, one of the most important things we can do is address bullying issues, take the things that children tell us seriously, always look into it, make sure we're not just dismissing anyone. So it was very interesting. And then Nurse Lisa is writing a 21st century Women's Centers grant. And so I've been helping her as best I can, but she's working on that and is hoping to have a rough draft ready by Wednesday.
And that's the one for the after school program.
Any questions for me?
Thank you.
President Smith, Mr. Woodard had asked when the library board meeting is. It's December 10th, next Monday at 5:00.
The high tunnel grant, we've applied for that with the, which is a unheated greenhouse. Am I saying that right? Weren't sure how that might work out with the school, but I think Jill Steinmates is going to be a part of that and provide some vegetables and fruits to the kitchen. And not sure how it's all going to work out and, if we would get that and utilize first science classes maybe as well. Mrs. Cornwell got a grant through Blue Cross and Blue Shield for healthy habits. I'm not exactly sure what all that will provide for training and activities for healthy habits. Do you know, either of you know, have you heard about her plans on that? Do you?
I don't know about the Blue Cross Blue Shield one, no. I don't remember.
She really does a great job with the grant situation. Career and college readiness, I'm going to send you something. I'll save that for my Friday note, just for time's sake here. Our professional development is really focused on the Common Core state standards, and thinking about that, moving to this new system, which goes along with the career and college readiness, these standards are a lot more rigorous. Our old standards and assessment focus on basic skills, rote memory type things. Now, it's easy for us to go through and say, well, these 13 things out of the curriculum we need to make sure we hit on, and we pound them into their heads, and we brag about our standard of excellence, and we've done that for years. We're trying to get away from that. Now, what do we do with the curriculum? The standards are the broad things that we need to follow, but we really need to nail down the curriculum. So this is really going to be a priority over the next year and a half, as it has been for some time, but we're still going to keep working on those things. Assessments. We're still giving the old state assessment to test the basic skills and the rote memory type things, and we're trying to get away from that. From the State Department, they've said, forget about this year's assessments, move on to the Common Core state standards, start focusing on those things. It's one thing to say that. It's another thing for me to say it and the principals to say it. But when the teacher gets right down to it, we've trained them over and over to we need to do well on these tests, and they take pride in that, and they should. But what message do we send? How do we send them the message? So I guess my question for you is, do we care about how we do on this year's assessments? Is it okay that we're moving on to the Common Core standards with the more rigorous standards and not focusing on those rote memory things? And we don't know how we'll do if we don't focus on those things and those formative assessments that go along with it. The No Child Left Behind waiver says AYP doesn't count. The scores are still printed in the paper. The results are public. So what is our message? Are we okay with that? As a group, are you okay with me telling the principals and the principals telling the staff, focus on Common Core, forget about test prep for the old assessment?
Why would we want to go backwards? if we're moving forward. So I think you answered your own question. Sometimes you accept what the reality is. If you don't focus on something, you may not have total results that are meaningless, so to speak, or you're heading to a new direction. So I think teachers need to focus on what's up and coming and move on. Makes sense. I'm speaking for myself.
You guys have
other thoughts?
But they're still not, the kids are still not taking the state assessment test, is that what you're saying?
Yes, under the old system, yeah.
For one, this is the last year.
No, one more year.
Next year.
Oh, next year. Next year, too. Even though they're not really holding COVID accountable for them, but they'll still be published. Our kids are going to do well on them.
Well, I would think they would.
I mean, we may see a little bit of a drop, but it's not going to be like a 50% drop or anything. The thing is the teachers are not going to spend time in preparation for them. And to me, you're just knowing that you're moving on to the Common Core ideas, this makes sense. Otherwise, you're going to confuse kids even. We would spend less time on test prep and more on broad learning and deeper learning. So, but I did want to get your feel for your thoughts on that. If we do see test score drop, which we likely would a little bit if we're not spending time with those that are right. Remember several months ago we talked about those kids that are just below proficient, and we get those kids right above the line, but the rest of them we don't worry about. We would focus less on just those ones right below the line, getting those above, focus on everybody and the deeper knowledge in the Common Core curriculum. So it sounds like we're okay with that. We're still taking the test. It's just not going to be a priority for us to cram for it.
Yeah. Okay. What do you and your teachers want to do? Or your principals? What are they on?
We need to move to the Common Core and focus on that.
Yeah.
Am I speaking for all of us there? And I think we are.
Mm-hmm.
I know we are.
Yeah.
But I mean, if you guys said you want us to bust our biscuit and do better on state assessments, they'd do it. I mean, they'll do whatever.
And this is hard for all of us. You know, look at data and we adjust. Instruction based on how kids are doing, and then we have that final test that shows what we've done. And now we're doing that with these other assessments, the benchmark that she just referred to, ongoing, and grouping kids, and focusing more broad than on those testing indicators. So I just want to make sure we're all on the same page there, and we will focus on the message that we send to teachers, because again, we can just say, don't worry about the test, and that may not mean a lot. It's more about the message that we send. The efficiency and effectiveness review, the Center for Innovative School Leadership study, Bill Stahlers came, as a reminder, visited with us. We've got surveys coming. The one for the Board of Education did not work right, so he's going to fix it. But I will send you that link. And you'll need to go online and complete that survey. I think it's 17 to 20. One of them was 17, one of them was 24 questions.
I want the 17 question.
And students will, high school students will complete a survey, parents will, and teachers and classified staff. So we'll be doing that over the next few months. We'll need to compile all that information by beginning of February, so we'll be beginning to work on that. Transportation, I'm pretty sure I mentioned this in one of the Friday notes, but all the vehicles are gone, the three buses and the Suburban brought in about $6,500 in insurance savings, will be about $1,000 a year. We do have a van coming that you all approved a few months ago, a couple months ago. I called and it was being delivered this week, hopefully. So, legislative update. We've talked some about the efficiency commission, or task force, I guess it is, appointed by the governor. There's been some frustration from district folks for two reasons. One is because the seven of you are voted in to make sure we're efficient. And it's kind of insulting that we get this top-down approach to tell us what's right for us and Dodge City what's right for them and Wichita what's right for them. The seven of you, the six of you with Barb, know what's best for our district. Also, the issue of why we really need to look at this is kind of self-imposed with the tax situation. We were in a tough spot initially, and now we've made it worse. So that's a lot of the frustration. The chairman of that task force, Ken Willard, visited with us the other day at a superintendent's meeting. I think he wants to do what's right. A lot of the things that are coming down, I think I sent you some of those. A multi-year budget. They're really looking at statewide things we can do, not looking at, you need to stop paying your superintendent so much. There's some of that discussion, of course, too, because they're not mandating consolidation. They're not looking at that. The governor said he wants that off the table. But a multi-year budget where we can plan for a little easier, we don't have to worry about in July what we're going to do as far as teacher raises and those things. We can kind of plan. Bond equalization, we don't have to worry about that here. For districts, poorer districts with lower valuation, they get equalization aid. So basically they can't raise enough money with their mill levy, so the state provides money for them. The problem with that is it's kind of an open checkbook. If a district passes a bond issue and the state doesn't have money, too bad, they have to pay it because they've agreed to. So they'll be looking at that. Capital outlay. Some districts transfer money from the general fund to capital outlay. They're going to look at putting a cap on that, which kind of makes sense. The state provides that money in the general fund to say, this is the money that you said you need to educate kids, and now you're plugging in the capital outlay for your building projects. So, and then if you build facilities, they provide new facilities waiting for students to go to those buildings. They're looking at eliminating that. Budget-wise, I didn't get this in your packet. I did want to show you this. The front side. I've heard some from the Kansas Policy Institute about how much money we spend and how. Schools spend so much money, and it's just been going up and up and up. Well, if you compare that, if you look at fiscal year 2013, this is Kansas personal income. So, of course, education spending has been going up. So has my insurance bill and my gas bill and what it takes to pay teachers so they can pay their water bill and gas bill at home. So, expenses increase, we all know that. So if you look at the percentage of, these are expenditures for school districts, and these are in, and this would be 123 billion here, 14 billion, as a percent of Kansas personal income. So the amount of money Kansans make, you can see it's not a lot different. It hasn't been going up and up and up. It hasn't been increasing indefinitely. The state general fund expenditures, same thing here, comparing that to personal income, which gives you a good measure of how much money Kansans have to spend. If you look at this, this might be pretty telling here, column 7. State general fund receipts. Now this is projected for next year.
This is an easy number to look at. The percent of personal income, well, it's 4.3. That's how much the state expects to take into the general fund next year. And expect to spend 4.6%. But that doesn't add up. So that's not sustainable. Something needs to happen. One of two things. Cut expenditures or increase revenue. Those are your options. That's what needs to happen. That's not sustainable. The governor says he wants to maintain school funding. Now, does that mean if CAPERS funding goes up and special ed funding goes up, we just drop the base state aid and we pay the same dollar amount? I don't think that's the case. I think the governor's intention is to fund the same base state aid per pupil next year. But, as you can see, math doesn't lie. It's not a sustainable situation. So, on the back side, there's the backside does include CAPERS as well, so if you need some of that. But I did want to bring that up to you. We hear so much from the Kansas Policy Institute about how much money we spend. I think it is important to look at that. With our legislature this upcoming year, 40% of the senators are new to the Senate. 40% of the of the members of the House this year will be new to the legislature. That's a lot of new faces in the House and the Senate. And we don't know a lot about them as far as how they might support public education. Somebody had mentioned it's going to be like opening up a fire hose of education legislation. And there's going to be a moderating voice that's going to temper some of that. And maybe hold back some of the craziness, and that voice is coming from the governor. The governor is going to be the moderate voice with a lot of this, which politically, even with education, that's a scary situation. So here's some of the legislation that we may be looking at this year. And this is just, this is nothing official, just some talk. Looking at grading schools, A through F, I don't know how you feel about that. But the voucher situation is a scary situation. I don't know how much that would affect us around here, but bigger cities would sure be scary. Holding back 8-year-olds if they can't pass a reading test. A lot of this comes from Florida. Teacher issues, tenure negotiations, licensure is really just to get more teachers in the profession, loosen those regulations, and unions. There will be some battles with teacher unions this year, looking at tenure. And you've seen some stuff in other states. Finance issues. There was a push to redesign the school finance formula last year, which would require a constitutional change. We've discussed some of that. The local levies, we'd have to push to limit how much we can raise locally without publishing or having an election. The political issues. Some discussion about moving school board elections to November general election, school and city. So we will see what happens in the upcoming session. Web hosting, we're going to look at, ESDAC hosts our website right now.
and we're going to look at possibly moving that somewhere else. Right now, I maintain that website. It's difficult to use for anybody else but one person to update and use, and it's frankly not that easy for me. So there's some user-friendly setups that we have to pay a little money for. So I'm looking at getting that added to our E-rate next year, so it will be a significant discount. The district leadership team already discussed that. We, in addition to the capital outlay, we talked about what we want to keep definitely in the district and what we really need to change. And a lot of what we saw in our building tour is a lot of what we want to change, what that group wants to change. So that's about all I have there. Any questions for on any of these things?
Have you had a chance to talk to Mitch Holmes yet?
I have not, no. And that's is on my list, Mitch and Marshall Chrisman, I think is his name. Okay.
We'll move on to executive session items.
Let's go 15 minutes, and we'll keep Andrea and Mike in for the first few minutes. Okay. Then a break.
Executive session for 15 minutes to discuss personnel and negotiations. Is there any discussion? All in favor, raise your hand. Please stand aside. Have any future agenda items?
I don't have anything to mention. Okay.
That's all. I'll entertain a motion for adjournment.
Mr. President, I move to adjourn.
Second.
Move executive to adjourn. All in favor, raise your hand. Please stand aside. Thanks for your time.